Good morning and welcome to the 27th meeting in 2022 of the Equalities, Human Rights and Civil Justice Committee. With no apologies for this morning's meeting. The first item on our agenda today is to take evidence from the Minister for Equalities and Older People on our pre-budget scrutiny, and I refer members to paper one. So I welcome to the meeting Minister Christina McKelvey, Minister for Equalities and Older People, and she's supported by officials Aileen Flanagan, Interim Strategic Lead for Disability, Older People, BSL, Social Isolation and Loneliness and LGBTI Equality, and Rob Priestley, Interim Head of Mainstreaming and Strategy Unit in the Directorate for Equality, Inclusion and Human Rights. You're all very welcome. Minister, would you like to make some brief opening remarks before we move to questions?
Yes, I would, Convener, and thank you and good morning, everyone. Convener, thank you so much for inviting me to your pre-budget scrutiny session, during which I think we'll all agree is one of the most difficult budget rounds that we have had since devolution, certainly in my 15 years of being in this place. Firstly, I'm sure the committee must share my frustration that at this very late stage in terms of preparing our own budget, we are still playing a waiting game with Westminster, and it's unnecessarily challenging to undertake business in this way when the goalposts keep changing. Even the dates for announcements are changing rapidly and it's quite hard to keep up with it sometimes. So, Convener, the reckless behaviour of successive Prime Ministers has left us in a situation of crippling inflation, which has reduced the Scottish Government budget by around £1.7 billion from when it was published just last December. The forthcoming budget is taking place in a context of impending recession, with record levels of inflation affecting the Scottish budget funding base, decreasing the spending power of available funds whilst the demand for spending increases, and you'll have seen many of those demands in your budget scrutiny. This necessitates difficult decisions to be made so that we do not increase the pain felt by those most marginalised in our society, and of course that's all the folks in my portfolio who I'm hoping we have better outcomes for. But I am under no illusion as to the size of the task that lies ahead of us. The cost crisis is of a scale that we have not seen before. So I want to make it clear that this government understands that all budgetary decisions have an impact on equality and human rights, which is why we need to bake it into our processes. Taking an equality and human rights approach means looking holistically at our available resources and how we can further the realisation of human rights with what we have available. That is why we continue to focus on support for the most vulnerable. Direct examples are our Equality and Human Rights Fund and Delivering Equally Safe Fund. Amongst a range of projects getting over £4 million to the front line, the Equality and Human Rights Fund supported 38,000 people through one-to-one casework and helplines just in its first 6 months. We've published both those reports if the committee is interested and seen that in much more detail. This support is increasingly dominated by responding to the cost crisis, such as helping with benefits, housing and applying for home energy and food bank vouchers. And the Delivering Equally Safe Fund, which targets support at eradicating and supporting survivors of violence against women and girls, has provided £9.5 million to 121 projects over its first 6 months as well, and that report's been published too. These projects give one-to-one emotional and practical support as well as refuge, legal and financial advice and other services. Many of the organisations also run training and outreach programmes aiming to prevent violence against women and girls, and prevention is one of our key pillars in Equally Safe. I was very moved and inspired, and hopefully you may have seen it, but if you didn't, please go and have a look at it, by a recent visit that I did and the conversations that I had with women supported by the Saoirse Project, a project I visited in Blantyre, and if you're from that area, Blantyre, they will not forgive me for mispronouncing it. So that project, directly supported by the Delivering Equally Safe Fund, it brings together specialist domestic abuse and substance use services to target the multiple complex issues their service users face, helping them rebuild their lives. The women I spoke to were able to tell their story once. So that one door where they tell their story once and all the services click into place. And that's what Saoirse gave those women, and the resultant access to support and tailored needs for the individuals who needed tailor interventions. They were empowered to shape the decisions about their support and what that looked like, which was incredibly important. And this project represents a human rights approach to recovery with survivors right at its heart. A great example, and one that, if I said, if you've not seen what they do, please have a look. And that is just one example of the projects across Scotland offering lifelines to survivors of violence and abuse and seeking to tackle the root causes of the issue. And I can truly say it was absolutely awe-inspiring. The women I met that day, you know, will be in the front of my mind every single time I make decisions on how we spend the money that we have. So I'm incredibly committed to continuing support to such projects and our other third sector partners through these increasingly difficult times. As well as working with external partners, we continue to work across government to ensure equality and human rights are considered in the evidence-based policy making taking place in our portfolios. And that's why Rob's here, because mainstreaming is a key part of all of that. And this government is demonstrating it is serious about supporting those who have been and continue to be hit hardest by a recession of crisis in Brexit, the pandemic, and now the cost of living. Moving on, the government's Equality Data Improvement Programme, and I know that you've asked me about this in the past, so I can give you some update on that today, is building a stronger and more robust equality evidence base. This work is vital to ensuring that we have all the information available to make decisions that will support the needs of those most impacted by the cost crisis in Scotland. And that's by taking an intersectional approach and ensuring that the areas where the deepest deprivation is or the deepest discrimination is, that we can focus and tackle our resources appropriately in that. So we're driving forward our work on the Human Rights Bill, which will incorporate a number of international treaties into Scots law, giving justiciability to people's rights is an incredibly important part of the work that I'm doing in government right now. I've met with the stakeholders across Scotland to hear their views on this. They've been very motivated by this piece of work and all of the work that we are doing. But on the draft budget for this year, this includes funding to ensure that the bill's consultation is accessible and inclusive. And I know that's of a big interest to this committee, so that diverse voices and communities can participate in the legislative process. And we're working with the Scottish Learning Disability Association in the work that they're doing. They did a fantastic presentation on the incorporation of rights and what they mean from them. So again, if you've not had a chance to see that, have a look at, you know, the outcomes from the decisions that we take. Convener, I want to end my remarks by repeating my commitment to take an equality and human rights-based approach to the budget. If we do not take seriously the prerequisite for detailed needs analysis and do not listen to the views of the most vulnerable in our society, then we will not address the crisis affecting our most vulnerable citizens. And I'm committed to keep doing that. And I look forward to hearing from the committee this morning. Thanks, Convener.
Thanks very much, Minister. And we'll now move to questions. When this committee was first formed and considered our budget process last year, we decided that we would, for the period of the Parliament, have a focus on human rights budgeting. And we knew at that time that we were at the start of a process, and that actually, whether it's this committee, the Parliament, the Government, we were all leading the way in terms of this work. So it would be good to hear what that means for you. For us, one of the things that we did last year was to ask other committees to recognise that human rights isn't specifically just for this committee, and really pleased to see that a couple of the other parliamentary committees have specifically looked at human rights within their remit. So that's, and as part of their budget process, so that's been really good to see. One of the first things we did as part of our budget process this year was to hear directly from a number of organisations in the roundtable, which in the public session last week, which no doubt you'll have seen a note of. We also heard directly from People First in our private session, and it was really important for us to hear the lived experience of people in terms of what budgeting means for them. One of the things that we heard both from People First and from the wider panel was that in order to be part of the budget process, they need to be able to understand, they need to be able to see it. So that transparency and participation was a theme that came through last weekend. So a number of our committee members will focus on transparency and participation. But one thing that was very, very clear point was around being able to access the budget documentation. So there was a call that all documentation, and particularly the explainers, that the parts of the budget documentation which says what this means for you as an individual or for you as a group should be in easy read and other formats, so BSL, etc. So I just wonder what progress the government is making in terms of not just making the main budget documents, but the accompanying documents available so that people can participate.
Yeah, thanks very much, Convener. I heard those comments from people first last week, myself, and was pleased to see that we are making real progress in this area. I think we recognise that accessibility is an important part of ensuring that the key stakeholders have their say and see themselves within the work that we do as well. You'll know that we have accessible communications legislation in place now anyway, and as we move forward with our Human Rights Bill, there'll be a right within that around about having access to documents in the format that you do, but we currently do quite a lot of that, and we currently do publish many of our documents, the sort of a high-level documents. I suspect people first and others are looking for the more detailed work that's ongoing on that. So we are currently exploring all the options on how to do that, not just in easy read, but in other accessible formats. So we've committed, and we are now producing documents in plain text format, which we have direct feedback from stakeholders about how important that has been and why it's made it so much more accessible. I don't take any decisions in my portfolio at all without ensuring that I work very closely with stakeholders. That means actually producing what we produce in a format that is their preferred method of communication. So we do a lot of that already. But as far as, the deeper budget documents and the ask from people first, we're currently exploring how we can do more of that. So I can give you that commitment and then update you when we've got that review completed.
Well, thanks very much. And yeah, it would be really appreciated if we can just get an update as that work progresses. Maggie.
Thanks very much, Joe. Good morning. Thank you for joining us, and thank you for your opening words, Minister. I hear very, very strongly the commitment to human rights and equalities budgeting and embedding that, mainstreaming that across all processes, and that holistic approach that you talk about. And of course, that's important if we are genuine, if we're going to see genuine action around the prevention agenda across the elements that you highlighted. I'm interested in how we make the connections between the assessments that we do, the equalities impact assessments that we do once budgets are determined, and how we actually link those two outcomes. Because I think so often equalities impact assessments, we go through a process, it seems to be a desktop process, rather than... It has meaning, but it's always looking back the way. And I'm wondering what is your assessment of how we are doing in doing that as a continuous thing? So, as we start talking about the budget that we will be agreeing in the next few months, how are we doing the assessments around equalities, around inclusion and that kind of thing now, so we don't just have to look back at it when everything's done in February?
Yeah, no, thanks very much. So there's a number of legislative and non-legislative ways that we do that. We obviously have the Fair Scotland duty, and we have our processes and EQIA development. Part of the work that I've been doing over the past few years is to look at EQIAs, to find the gold standards and to ensure that they are used all the way through government. That's a big part of the mainstreaming team and the work that they're doing. So we've offered a number of opportunities for other colleagues across the whole of government to take part in training and experience in the way to do EQIAs that detail the outcomes that we want to see, because that's the important part of this. It's not just about complete the document, it's about what does it actually do, and then how can we measure progress against that. So that's a few ways that we do that already. The most effective place, I think, for EQIAs is throughout the cycle of the development. So it's not something you do at the end of the process or, even just at the beginning of the process. It's something that has to be a living document. So always has to be going through all these processes. And we do that so that it informs our decision-making as we go a step at a time. So whether it's annual budget allocations, the help, that we give to people, or actually seeing those outcomes. And I mentioned the Cercia project, and there's a number of others. I've got a whole list of them in the back of this folder. I'll give you some of them in a second. But they then measure that against our national performance framework. So what are our, what have we committed to making progress on in the national performance framework, and how does that map across to what we are doing with an EQIA, and then what that EQIA does to inform that policy making and then create those better outcomes. So we go all the way through that. Of course, we've committed to doing some work around about the emergency budget, and we've done some work around the RSR. These are pretty exceptional times to do that, and we do have the Fairer Scotland budget statement that comes along with that. And amongst all of that is Angela Hagan and her team, who are now being renamed. So I've just extended the remit of that group and extended Angela's contract with us to chair that group. So they're now called the EHRBAG group. So it's okay. A wee bit, used to be EBAG, now it's airbag, but it doesn't sound right. So we're not using it. We're not using that. So we've extended the influence that they have there. Okay. And we have looked at many ways in which we can improve these processes. We have reviewed that. We have some draft work in place. And we have now given that back to Angela to have a look at it to see, are we on the right track? Okay. Because I think having that good critical friend, having that organisation that sits there, scrutinises the work that we do, analyses the work that we do, but gives us the recommendations back in which to do that. And they've been very motivated in doing that, and they have given us a bigger piece of work to look at, which we are currently in draft format of how we respond to that too. So, okay. I can give the committee updates when Angela comes back. I'm meeting with her soon as well, so we have sort of our regular catch-ups to do that. But I think having, those judicial processes, the things that we have to do, the Fairer Scotland duty and all that, having the other processes around about what we must do to make sure that decisions are made effectively and create outcomes, and working with stakeholders and external organisations to be that critical eye and to give us some guidance, support and recommendations on how we move that forward. So that's the process. Yeah. What we then see is projects like the CERSHA project, where we take an intersectional approach to the challenges that women who are victims of domestic violence, who also maybe have a substance abuse or an addiction issue, get the right support in a one-stop shop. And when it comes down to it, that's what makes the difference, is seeing, the outcomes for those women.
Yeah. No, thank you. That's really helpful. I suppose part of my question is motivated by comments made from service providers that are funded through different bits of Scottish Government funding around the resource spending review, and them looking at some of the directions of travel that were laid out in that. And I know things have moved on sometimes in the wrong direction for the reasons you outlined in the intervening 6 months. But I think there is concern around decisions being taken without actually understanding the consequences in terms of material outcome. And part of that, and I know others might want to pick up on that, you mentioned the National Performance Framework. I suppose linking that to what we actually consider to be where we should be, how do we see the National Performance Framework actually giving us the outcomes that we want. I think Pam Duncan Glancy will come in later on and talk about the issue of minimum core, when we're dealing with those kinds of questions. But it seems to me that we don't always understand the consequences of the decision we take here. And I'm curious to know whether you think we're moving in the right direction, because I don't think we've got everything in place yet. And where are the pressure points that you see that we actually need a little bit more intervention to better understand the consequences of financial decisions?
Yeah, no, it's a good point, and thanks for it. I was Pam Duncan Glancy was looking there to say, "Don't you steal my thunder?"
sorry, Pam.
I'm sure you can. I think when I said in my comments earlier about I don't make any decisions without having the people that I want to affect change for in the front of that. That's the reason why we use lived experience panels. We use the stakeholder events. There is many other organisations to do a fantastic, array of events. We attempt to, work with all of those, and we take feedback. And that's the important part here. So the two reports that we have done on the Delivering Equally Safe Fund and the Equality Human Rights Fund is peppered all the way through with the feedback from the people who both benefited and found some challenges and some resolutions, actually, because they had some ideas on how they fix some of the challenges as well. That's peppered all the way through that piece of work. We can see who's been impacted, who's accessing the services, what they think of the services, and how we take that forward. And we also do that with the fund managers who are working with us. So they're your monitoring and auditing processes have been developed over the past wee while, where it was maybe a straight monitor and all financial, mm-hmm. you know, did you spend your money on this and you've made this outcome? It's a bit deeper than that and a bit more soft in its benchmarking on it, because there is outcomes that would not be caught in those more formal ways. So having those conversations and injecting those thoughts, feelings, experiences into all of that work has allowed us to look at, you know, what we've done. And that's why we did those 6 month reviews, because we wanted mm-hmm. to see, right, what difference has this made, and you know, and we see that very, very clearly. A piece of work that came in via email from Scottish Women's Aid just a few months ago at the beginning of the cost crisis was from Jo Osga at Scottish Women's Aid, who did a 2-page document on this is how bad this is for women. You know, we were able to use that piece of work and, you know, work with other colleagues in government and work with other colleagues across the officials team, with my team and finance and exchequer, to respond to that in a way that gave that sector some stability. It's only for 6 months, right enough, but it's some stability now, and I felt that was really important. But that's a perfect example of how stakeholders and their experience can be injected straight in to the decisions that we need to make, and then those decisions given the outcomes that people want to see.
Super. Thanks. I'll leave it there.
Okay, thank you. And Rachel.
Thank you, Convener. Minister, last week the SWC suggested that women and girls were being overlooked in the current budgeting arrangements. And I just wondered if you had an opinion after the first Minister's Women and Girls Advisory Council, who want to see intersectional gender budget analysis integrated into the Scottish budget process, and they want that to be put on a statutory footing. I wondered what your opinions were on the current arrangements for gathering disaggregated data, and would you agree that putting intersectional gender budgeting on a statutory footing would support policy making in terms of how women and girls are funded in the approach to, say, childcare or social care?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I absolutely accept the principle of integrating intersectional gender analysis in all of our policy making. I'm an intersectional feminist, I always have been, so I've never looked at, you know, my characteristic of being just a woman. You know, we're all different and we have a set of characteristics that brings us together. Where those characteristics cross over at those intersections for some women is where the deepest areas of either deprivation, discrimination or lack of access to better outcomes manifest themselves. The pandemic certainly exposed that in a really stark way. So we are very keen to make sure that process of integrating intersectional budget process will allow us to take forward some of the work that we do in the wider equality and human rights budgeting. And that's why I go back to the point I made about always going back to stakeholders. So all of those women's organisations that, you know, are currently stakeholders in the work that we do, we work very, very closely with them. We also work with the Scottish Women's Budget Group, who you'll have seen some of the work that they do. And they have been working with officials in our government to train us in a number of these areas. So we have been attending training delivered by the Scottish Women's Budget Group, basically to grow the competence, gender competence in this area. And we hear a lot of that about, well, you know, where are women in this? Where are, you know, minority ethnic people in this? Where are gypsy travellers in this? I hear that a lot. So it's been able to pull all of that out and having that there. We recognise the impacts of the crisis will not be felt equally by some people and certainly by women, and there'll be a disproportionate impact on households and groups, including women. And these are households where, you know, 90 odd percent of single parent households in Scotland are the head of the household is a woman, you know, and lots of those families, they're a carer or they have, you know, a disabled person within that family as well. So you know, we take all of that into account and we recognise that these are the people who would be affected the most. We're also exploring whether the public sector equality duty and the Scottish specific duties could be an appropriate vehicle in place to put this on a statutory footing. So I'm not saying no to a statutory footing, but we're still investigating whether that's the right way to go, and there's different opinions around that from the sector. So we have actually asked for stakeholder views on specifically that point, on the practicality and the feasibility of placing a duty on listed authorities to do this. So we're awaiting that work coming back on that as well. And, you know, supporting those families, the child payment is a perfect example of, you know, the Bridgman payments being doubled, the child payment being doubled, and how that is now paid up to age of 16 is a perfect example of how we understand where this impact affects women and affects families, where we can then inject some of our resources to bring those inequalities up to a point where people, you know, are not being either discriminated against or marginalised because of their status in society. They're, you know, they're valued, and the work that they do is mums and carers are valued too.
I think you're absolutely right. I mean, there are challenges, as have been highlighted by Fraser Allender and Joseph Rowntree Foundation on that gathering of that disaggregated data. We heard last week as well that there were issues around non-disclosure, GDPR, you know, working within the parameters of the Equalities Act to ensure that all data for people with protected characteristics was gathered, but not necessarily disaggregated. And so, therefore, it'd be interesting how the Scottish Government take this forward. I just want to highlight as well that Audit Scotland have highlighted that there are data gaps in social care, and that is much wider, they said, than in healthcare. And how these data gaps are contributing is causing a huge challenge. So it's how the Scottish Government work with local authorities and how they understand the national picture to work together. And I wondered if you had any opinions on how the Scottish Government could improve that relationship, where the data gathering on a national basis is not necessarily being done, even though it is on a statutory footing, and not shared with the local authorities, which doesn't allow the local authority then to provide the social care that it needs to.
Just double checking something there. Okay, yeah, so data and the collection disaggregation and the quality of the data we collect is a huge piece of work that we are doing in government right now. It's an issue that has been, since my first ever outing on a committee 15 years ago in this place, we have been looking at both how we collect and how we use and how we disaggregate and how we share data to make the better outcomes. So a big piece of work that's been ongoing right now is around about the quality data improvement projects, and over the summer the Chief Statistician consulted on equality data improvement plans, and those cut right across the whole of government. I think COSLA have their own approaches to this, so maybe it's worth having some evidence from COSLA. There's a new committee chair there, and I'm working very closely with her. I'm meeting with her in the next few days to discuss some of this work, and amongst all the other things that where our jobs cross over. So we obviously do have the public sector equality duty in place right now, but you've made the point about, you know, where there's statutory footing and it's not being collected. They would maybe argue that it is, but it's maybe we don't see what we need in it, and then that's where we need to improve what we're doing right now. So the publication of the next equality evidence strategy, which will cover years 23 to 25, will be in spring 2023, so I can come back to committee at that point and let you know what that looks like. That will mark the conclusion of the first stage of EDIP, we call it, the Equality Data Improvement Project. So that will mark mark the first stage of that. We are in autumn 2021. We had an internal network of lead analysts covering all ministerial portfolios. So you picked up the point about social care and other data gaps across other parts of government, where it's not for me to respond for those government ministers. But that work, that mainstreaming work, has been done right across the whole of government. And that was So it was an audit of equality data collected and published in key data sets and how that was then used to produce official and national statistics. Update the national performance framework, because it's all linked to that, and all of those indicators, and to inform significant ministerial decision making. Now, what's interesting now is we have this other piece of work that's going on. So we're reviewing the public sector equality duty, we're doing the equality data improvement project, and we're also doing the mainstreaming work. They all work together to make all of those changes that we need to see. And what I see now coming through in my For Info folder, which is usually things that are happening across government, is a much more both gender, human rights and equality a budget and focus on all of that work. So I'm seeing that beginning to, you know, emerge through other parts of government. On the issue about social care in particular, happy to take that back to the minister responsible for that and get you some answers on that. As I say, we carried out a public consultation in the summer, and people would maybe think that, you know, data and data collection and how we use it and disaggregate it is a pretty dry subject. You should have been at the Data Kirk event I was at yesterday with the chief statistician, who did a presentation on data, and you could see people going, oh my goodness, this is going to be... But it was not uninteresting at all. It was incredibly interesting. He linked it to SIMDs and how SIMD data is collected and how we then use that. The other piece of work we're doing around about data is how we collect data in regards to hate crime. And I'm leading on that piece of strategy in that as well. So their quality evidence strategy all ties into all of those parts of government too. And alongside that consultation, we carried out a series of stakeholder engagement events. So going back to the people who are asking for this, there's incredible interest in government data, how we commission it and how we use it. And to help us to understand the practical steps, what do people need to see in order for them to make the right decisions? Because this is not just about government making decisions, it's about organisations who deliver services looking at that and saying, oh, here's an intersection where we maybe hadn't picked that up, let's focus some resources on it. Or, you know, there's some progress that we've made, let's highlight that as an example of progress. So there's all of that as well. Addressing the barriers to collecting data, some of it is about systems and how we develop systems, and they're developing rapidly all the time, and we're using all of that advance in technology to look at how do we have, you know, drop-down menus, simple ways of collecting as much data as possible. So one of the criticisms I had from some of the people who were at Data Kirk yesterday, that was a Black Talent Summit event yesterday, was that they said that people from mainly African heritage communities are just denoted as African. And yet there is so many more different ways in which they could be identified in that data set. And that was one of the issues that the expert reference group in COVID ethnicity picked up during the pandemic. And we were able to analyse that in a way with National Records of Scotland to look at, well, what do we need and how do we use that, you know, to affect life-changing decisions on people, like during the pandemic, access to vaccines, you know, and access to accessible information that allowed them to access those vaccines and the support that they needed to have during that time. So that's another example of how, if you've got good data, you can use it to make a difference immediately. But we are of the mind that it needs improved all the time. Again, another living document that needs to just keep working and improving the whole time, and we're doing that.
Thank you, Convener. That was a very generous contribution the Minister made. And I think there are things that we can do right now, not necessarily looking to the future, to ensure that... I'd urge you to look at the evidence you probably have from last week, which was really, really fantastic from people with lived experience.
OK, thanks. Pam. Duncan Glancy.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener, and good morning to the Minister and your officials. Thanks for joining us. Some of my questions link on from what we've heard so far this morning. And in particular, I want to touch on some of the stuff that we heard last week from people with learning disabilities. We heard one of the things they asked was that the data be disaggregated for learning disabilities, because obviously when we collect data in the household survey, there's a question on disability, but it doesn't necessarily disaggregate that. And we heard from learning disabled people that that can be problematic. So could you set out what your intentions are around data collection in the household survey and specifically on learning disabled people? And also on the same vein, will you? I note what you said earlier on about a commitment to inclusive communication and the points you made around the human rights legislation. But those things are a bit further down the line. Would you be prepared to ask the government to publish an easy read version of the budget at this point in time?
Okay, I'll answer the last point first, Pam, because it's the easiest one. We're currently considering how we do that. So we produce a number of documents in different formats, XXL, Moon, Easy Read, and all of that. And usually it's the team at the Scottish Learning Disability Consortium that help us with that. So we're looking at ways to do that in Easy Read. So I'll come back to you on that, because we had that ask last week and we thought, oh no, we produced those documents in those formats, but we realised it was the deeper documents that help you understand what the budget means that people were looking for. We thought we'll go away and look at that. So we're doing that now, so we can come back to you on that point. Yeah, on the minimum core outcomes that we want to see, we realise that everyone in our society who experience disadvantage and inequality and who lack power, which is usually the case when they face having a challenge and realise that your human rights is a difficult way to go. So if you look at, you know, folks from the Gypsy Traveller community, for instance, from, people impacted by disability, from our minority ethnic communities, from LGBTI communities, you can see very, very clearly where, you know, there's areas of policy development where, you know, they would view it as lacking, you know, influence and power. And I gave an example of Jo Osgood's paper and how that can influence what we do. A few weeks ago, I met with the lived experience panel for the Human Rights Bill from the learning disability sector, and they did a superb presentation on what the treaties meant for them and what it meant for them to see that realised. I understand that that's a wee bit of time in the future and how we do that. So we're looking at what can we do now to ensure that people are engaged in all of that. So, the Social Renewal Advisory Board, had all of those organisations around the table. The Advisory Board for the Human Rights Bill have them. You know, any of the social security work that we do, it's lived experience panels that are involved in that as well. And it's hearing those voices and making the time to hear those voices. So in a way, so for me, I said to that group, right, you tell me what you need me to do and I will be there. Just, you know, what do you need? And they said, well, we've got a presentation, we want you to listen, then we want to quiz you with questions from that. I do a lot of that work. As I say, I don't make any of the decisions in my portfolio without having those folks at the front of my mind. My background is in learning disability, and I used to run a project called Promoting Independence, absolutely nothing to do with politics and everything to do with the independence of adults with learning disabilities. You know, so I have that sort of a professional understanding of where that is as well. But I also understand how impenetrable sometimes government and public authorities can be, especially if you've got a learning disability, you know, and your ways maybe of communicating are not the mainstream. Therefore, it's us that have to change our approach to make sure that, it's not for folks fitting into that. So that's why I do take that intersectional approach. I think, for folks that are impacted the worst in all of this, I do worry about, some of the groups, or Gypsy Traveller folks, for instance, the folk who have, had their universal credit cut, families who have someone within the household as a carer or with a disability, or indeed, our a learning disabled community in Scotland, and I do worry about the impact on all of them. So they're at the front of my mind when I make those decisions, but they're also in the room when I hear what they need and how we then use that to make those decisions. So that's the way, you know, informally, the way that I do it as an individual minister, and I know that other ministers across government do it that way as well. They've always got ideas on how we can do this better. I'm always open to those ideas on how we can do that better, and how, you know, people can see themselves in the policy that's being developed, and how they can see their influence within that policy too, and no more so than in the budget, because you would tend to find that those families or individuals are people who are most reliant on services, and if those services aren't there or don't work, or, you know, are not flexible enough, then people don't realise their own independence and their rights and all of that. So if you've got ideas on how we do this, I'm sure you have, Pam, because you always have, and it's always really helpful. I'm keen to hear that as well. And I know that we have lots of, you know, events along the way to reinforce and underpin all of this with legislation. But in the meantime, how do we make sure that those folks are in the room? And I do that to the best of my ability, but there's always ways to do it better, and I'm happy to take them on board.
Thank you. I appreciate that. And I thank the Minister for the commitment on the publication of Easy Read, or at least coming back to the committee to explain to us your approach to that, or the Minister's approach to that. I appreciate it. One of the issues that I think can happen quite a lot is this sort of interplay between the Minister who has responsibility for Equalities and the rest of government. And you've outlined the way that you do your business. And I think that, or the Minister has outlined the way that she does her business, sorry. And I think that's commendable. But I do worry about how other areas of government are doing the same thing. Last week, and I'll quote this, People First told us that for a long time, people with a learning disability have been considered last, if we're considered at all. That is true when it comes to budgeting decisions. It is true for pretty much any decision. We are not seen as important, and our human rights are not protected as they are for other citizens. We are not expected or supported to live our life like other citizens. I found that really quite stark last week, and some of the other evidence that People First gave us was too. So can the Minister set out what our expectations of the Cabinet Secretary for Finance are, and other Cabinet Secretaries and Ministers, in relation to this, to involving disabled people and others, and touching on my colleague Rachel Hamilton's point about the Scottish Women's Convention in relation to how women feel they had been overlooked in the budget. Could the Minister set out our expectations from the Cabinet Secretary for Finance and other ministers in government on how they should be considering these issues as they go forward in developing the budget proposals?
OK, it's probably not for me to set out what other ministers or cabinet secretaries will want to do in this area, but it's certainly for me and the mainstreaming team to ensure that those proposals, ideas, you know, resolutions to challenges are injected into the whole process, and that's what we are doing. I'll bring Rob in a minute to give you an update on where we are with the mainstreaming strategy and how that ties into this work as well. Disappointed to hear that you know, organisations felt as if, especially learning disability organisations, felt as if they were not listened to, or the last to be listened to. I'll certainly take that on board and deal with that. I think one of the big pieces of work that we did just before the pandemic, and we know that the pandemic had a disproportionate impact on some folks more than others, and certainly, you know, learning disabled people were very badly affected by the pandemic because they lost lots of their services. We had a programme developed at the time alongside COSLA, a joint programme called Keys to Life, which you probably know about that. So one of the things that I want to do now, and on the back of the comments that you've just articulated to me, Pam, is to go back and have a look at that, to speak to the Minister responsible now and see maybe if that's something that we should be looking at and making sure that those organisations and the people they represent, and more importantly, the people who are the stakeholders within those organisations, get to hear their voice in all of this. So I'll take that on board and take that back. But if Rob, if you want to give a wee update in mainstreaming, because mainstream is a pretty fast-moving feast right now, and it's been working right across the whole of government, but responding to emergency budget, responding to resource spending review, and responding to a normal budget, if we ever will have a normal budget round. But Rob can give you an update on that.
Thank you.
Thank you, Minister. I think it's important to highlight mainstream is an area that, you know, exactly your point, it cuts right across government, and how do we put these decisions right across government. So we're currently developing an equality and human rights mainstreaming strategy, which will cut across Scottish Government and the wider public sector. The initial work on that, we've conducted a number of deep dives with stakeholders, including areas around leavers and culture and competence. And then we're going through a current theme of further engagement just now. The themes that are coming out, which are likely to form the backbone of that strategy, are entirely relevant to the point. Key themes are in leadership and accountability. Mm-hmm. So how do we ensure appropriate leadership and accountability for equality and human rights? Culture and competence. So there's a question there, which is how do we ensure that everybody who's working in this area, it's not down to equality and human rights specialists, but everybody in government, wider public sector, has the appropriate level of competence in this area to embed in mainstream. And the final area is around policy coherence, which is how do we align the policy decisions to meet in this area as well. And that connects to some of the points we're making today. How do we connect the public sector equality duty and the review we're doing currently? And how do we connect the future work around the Human Rights Bill, as well as how do we connect policy more generally into equality and human rights?
I appreciate that. Thank you very much. I'll move on.
We'll come back if we can, yeah?
Yep.
Pam Gossel.
Thank you, Chair. Good morning to the Minister and the officials as well. The Minister spoke earlier on in the opening statement in relation to reaching out and helping violence against women and girls. And my question is really around how do you reach those communities that are hard to reach? For example, the BAME communities. We heard last week that some of the communities out there are hesitant to let people in and answer any questions, give their details, because sometimes they feel they're not heard and sometimes they feel that they don't know why they're giving the information for. So it'd be good to hear from the Minister how the Minister and the Government is going out to reach out to those communities. And do you provide any feedback to them after taking information from them?
So there's, you'll not be surprised, I think, to hear me say a similar thing about how policy development and policy outcomes are incredibly important, and they have to then be informed by that lived experience. And how, if you take an intersectional approach to this, these are the very women and folks that emerges as having multiple layers of both discrimination and equality issues. So again, it's the work that we do across our portfolio with stakeholders that's incredibly important. So me as a privileged white woman would not, ever articulate or even speak for some of the women in our diverse, or all of the women in our diverse minority ethnic communities in Scotland. So those stakeholder engagements are incredibly important. So, organisations like Amina or Shakti have spent a good amount of time over the summer meeting with a number of those stakeholders, and spent almost a full day at Shakti in Edinburgh. Hearing across different ways, we're talking about disaggregated data, so there was a number of women in there, but then there was a number of women from the Chinese community who had different experiences of how they were experiencing domestic abuse, and different for other women, maybe from different cultural backgrounds around about honour-based violence, FGM, and a number of other issues that are particularly female women orientated problems. So just actually sitting with my mouth shut and my ears opened to hear some of those stories and some of the issues that those women had. The same with the visit to the Saoirse project, women there who maybe come from areas of multiple deprivation, who are carers, who are victims of domestic violence, who also have addictions. All of those intersections is where we see the deepest inequality, and it's those intersections where we're focusing the work that we do. So the criteria for organisations, receiving delivering equally safe money in particular. We looked at partnership and we looked at intersectionality. Those had to be, in there. So that's why organisations like Shakti, Sahelia, Waverley Healthcare, and a number of others who were all involved in delivering that work allow me, as someone who would not experience, those experiences, to understand what happens, how it happens, and how then we can use those experiences to both inform and improve our approaches to all of that. The training for some of the staff. So a lot of these organisations do their training across lots of sectors. So, you know, embedding across many sectors, those intersectional approaches of when you have this particular individual walking through your door and they have these different types of characteristics, how do you tackle that? And who are the experts in the field that can help you to tackle that? You know, Shakti, Sahilia, others would say, it's us. Please come in and work with us. And that's why the Delivering Equally Safe Fund had that key element of partnership in it. Because, you know, by the best will in the world, someone walking through the door of an organisation and that organisation does not reflect them is a big step in the first place, but actually then to get through that door and to be signposted to both organisations and support that much more culturally or religiously appropriate or whatever that person needs, you know, is the way to do that. And Saoirse was a great example of that. So that's really the way I do it, and when we're mainstreaming across government, we're looking at how does money get spent in order to tackle these issues. You'll not be surprised. I work very closely with justice colleagues and other colleagues across other parts of government, whether it's in relation to our Equally Safe strategy, whether it's in health, whether it's in education, whether it's in access to services, you know, or access to justice, or being a victim or a witness going through the justice system as well. We've worked with many organisations to do that. We continue to work with them. And, you know, hopefully they will say we do feedback. Again, you know, you've sparked an idea in my head about maybe we should look at how we create some feedback loops and ways to go back to that. But I'll get an example of what we're doing right now with the EHRBAG group. is that the draft proposals that we have put in place to the recommendations that they gave us at the time, we have given them the draft to say, are we on the right road here? So going back, you know, to the stakeholders to say, right, this is where we think this will work. Does that work for you? And, you know, just testing that and making sure that when it comes to its final publication, it works. And that person who walks through that door, whether, you know, it's a minority ethnic woman or other protected characteristics, that they get the service they need and they deserve.
I thank the Minister for being honest, obviously reaching out. We need to use all the organisations we have out there and also the partnerships to make sure we reach out. The good news is, obviously, I can say that my mother came back to me last week to ask one of the group, I think there's an exercise you're doing out there with probably one of the organisations, and it was to do with this, and said that, should I go to this? With her friends, and I said certainly she should. So that was the first time it's reached out to my mum in that many years. It's never reached out, and she's quite heavily involved with the community. So on that question, I want to ask, which is good news that it's reached out. Do you sometimes think it's fantastic that the organisations, and I talk to all these organisations you've mentioned, are doing a great job, but sometimes to get on the ground, do you think there's more that the government can do to get out there to reach maybe in religious settings, because everybody, the congregations are massive in all the religious settings, and maybe to reach out through that more an awareness first rather than just going data collecting. You know, sometimes people need to know who you are, what you're doing, an introduction of what you're doing, rather than going straight into using an organisation, which is very helpful. But sometimes people are missed because, like I said, and my mother only found out because somebody spoke about that organisation in the temple. That's where she is all the time. So basically, and I was very pleased that the government is reaching out like that. So what's your views on that, Minister?
I totally agree with you, Pam. Please tell your mum to engage in that, and I'm going to find out what exactly. I think I've got an idea what it is, but I'm going to find out and just find out how did we do that so that we can replicate that across the board. So from that point of view, you make a really good point about faith communities. So since the change in portfolios after the election last year, faith communities came into my portfolio. So I've spent the last 6 months or so building up relationships with faith communities. I've just a few weeks ago met with all the faith leaders. And it's interesting, there's a few women around that table, you know, so we need a few more women around that table as well. But I have to say, you know, the interaction with all of those faith leaders was incredibly positive. That particular meeting was around about hate crime, but there was another few other issues that were brought up at that time. I've done a number of events over the summer, whether it's with Shabir Beg and the Isle of Bat Association, whether it was attending the Interfaith Scotland event in at the Bahia Temple in Edinburgh just at the end of June, and their whole focus was about women and about women's gender and inequality. So I was able to take part in that and answer questions in that format as well. Of course, the National Advisory Council for Women and Girls' last piece of work was really focusing in on minority ethnic women and the work that they did, and looking at faith communities when they do that as well. But you make a point, so it's something over the last 6 months that I've been getting up to speed with, because it didn't sit in this portfolio before it sat in communities. So I've been doing a lot of work to build those relationships, because when you build those relationships, then you get good, frank and honest feedback as well, because that you build an element of trust. And I'm hoping that, you know, the project that your mum hopefully is going to be involved in is just an example of the many ways in which we will do that. But I'm going to go back and just have a wee look at how we did that bit and make sure that we can replicate it across the board.
Thank the Minister for that. Thank you.
Thank you. And Karen?
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister. Really, following on from what you were just discussing there with Pam in terms of that outreach, we do find that the most marginalised feel the most disenfranchised, really, from decision-making in society. And so I'm glad to hear there is those outreach processes ongoing. What can we do to ensure that it's not just at the end of the process, the budgetary processes, and that there is a system where they can input all through that from beginning to end?
Yeah, so that's an ask from a number of forums and organisations. So National Advisory Council for Women and Girls, was one of the recommendations. But policy coherence, so not just about the budget process, but how we do that better, and how does policy work together to get the better outcomes. I suppose, you know, the Equality and Fairer Scotland budget statement has... You know, the work's been done to reverse that a bit, for it not to be done at the end of the process, but to be started at the beginning of the process. And, you know, how this place does its budget scrutiny is an example of that as well. So, you know, your pre-budget scrutiny, all the questions you've asked me today about process, how you engage with process, how we get stakeholders' voices heard in that process, and how we do that much better. A number of the recommendations from the previous iteration of Angela O'Hagan's group, EBAG, was around about how we... improve those processes. Number of recommendations, we're carefully considering them all. As I say, we have a draft response to that that has gone back to that group to make sure that we're on the right path. And as soon as I have that feedback back and we come to conclusions on that, can certainly, you know, give that to the committee for your consideration and the process, because much of that is about how do we ensure that, you know, we take an equality, a panel principles approach at the beginning of every policy development. And every policy development will have a financial, you know, impact on it. So, you know, not looking at the budget at that point, it seems, you know, a bit myopic, but so that's some of the work that we're doing now. I think when I think about when we did budget scrutiny, when I first came to this place, I was on the Education Committee and we did a piece of work of trying to track a pound from government to the front line, and it was impossible, especially when it started to go through local authority and COSLA agreements and all of that. It was a bit more tricky. Where what we produce now, you know, gives us a clear understanding of, you know, how equality and human rights considerations can make budget processes and the outcomes much fairer, much better, and tackle, you know, the endemic and systemic inequality that we currently have. So it's much better. I'm not saying it's perfect, because it's not, and that's why we're considering the recommendations from the EHRBAG group.
That's great. Thank you.
Thank you. And Fulton.
Thanks very much, Convener, and good morning to the Minister and our colleagues. I had a few questions around accountability, but actually a lot of it's been covered. And the question I do want to ask is on the back of my colleague Karen Adams there, and I know it's an area the Minister always highlights, and that is around this issue that I think is very difficult for the public generally, where the Scottish Government and the Scottish Parliament as a whole might have a range of policies with human rights at its core, and then perhaps when they are implemented, or these policies, or, you know, etc., are implemented by local authorities or other public sector bodies, that doesn't always seem to be the case on the ground. I was wondering if the Minister could comment. I know in her response to Karen Arden there, she was talking about how we can follow the money to see if it's, or how difficult that is to follow the money to see if it's been implemented that way. But I wonder if there's anything more broader we can do to make sure that all bodies are working together to implement these policies in a human rights way. And I'll just say as well for the committee to know, they might be interested in this, because I did raise a specific example in my constituency last week. Although I wasn't looking for a specific answer to that about a mobility hub, I just want the committee and the minister to know that following raising that last week, I had an email within about an hour and a half of committee advising me that indeed the campaign had been successful and that service is going to be saved. So whether somebody somewhere was watching the committee session or not, I don't know. But I think as a committee as a whole, you may be interested in that, and I'd like to put my thanks to the committee for allowing me to raise it. And you know, it's plausible that it was a part in saving that service. Anyway, I just wanted to put that on the record. Minister, my question is not about the mobility hub, which has now been saved. It was more about that general question about how good human rights policies and ideas and legislation at this parliament can be implemented across the board. And I know that there's difficulties with funding, etc. Thanks.
Yeah, no, thanks. Thanks for your comment. I'm glad to hear about the project and your constituency. It's always good when a campaign's successful in that way, but then you tend to think, why did we need a campaign in the first place, you know, if good decisions are made at the earliest stage? I think there's a number of things in here that we do. Obviously, the Equality Human Rights Budget Statement that comes along with budgets is an important tool that can be used in order to understand and mainstream and influence. The other piece of bits of work that, you know, focus in on that is the Fairer Scotland duties and the public sector equality duty, and we're currently reviewing them alongside the work that we are doing on mainstreaming and on the new Human Rights Act in order to make sure that they all work with each other and they all work well. So we've had a lot of response back on the public sector equality duty a review from stakeholders, you know, asking us to go further and deeper. Many of the organisations in race equality contacted us in the summer to ask us to go further and deeper. So we decided to take a bit more time to spend with stakeholders in order to influence and focus that process appropriately to meet their needs. That also includes working with our colleagues in COSLA and the work that they're doing. So the new boards are literally just, you know, getting off the ground. I've met with Councillor Chalmers, who's the new chair of the Wellbeing Board, where much of this portfolio sits, and I've met her on a few individual events, issues. So just general, you know, I getting to know you and what the focus of the committee will be over the next few years, but also looking at where we can collaborate on work. So public sector equality duties, Fairer Scotland duties and the general core duties on local authorities is an area where we will get into some work on that. I'm meeting with her in the next few weeks around about our work with women in domestic abuse and gender discrimination and inequality. And I'm also meeting with her in a few weeks on a specific point of our new human rights bill. So that's working with local authorities and other public sector folks, but looking at how do we improve those processes, and that's where the PSED review is being done right now. Obviously, the Equality Data Improvement Project it demands plans as well. And you know, if we are going to strengthen public sector equality duties, then the data that's collected, used and disaggregated is incredibly important in all of that. So that ties in to that work too. And then how we use all that to influence is incredibly important. And you know, a Human Rights Act for Scotland will incorporate four treaties, will include equality clauses, which, because there's no UN treaties for older people and LGBTI people, we're looking at how do we incorporate equality clauses that allows them the same judicial effect as the UN treaties would have in law. Part of that is about people not having their human rights and inequality issues realised by public authorities, and it's a but yeah, tough, you know, legislative tool to use. I would rather, you know, public authorities were upholding their Fairer Scotland duties or their public sector equality duties in a way that people feel their rights are not being disrespected and they don't have to go to judicial remedies for that. But that gives us another tool in the box in order to affect societal, organisational and institutional change. And we know that's what needs to happen. We've been working towards this for all of these years. We see progress now, but there is more to do and I'm always open to hearing ideas on how we do that. And just one example of where we spend money and where that makes a difference is one of the organisations that's funded through our funds and are included in our 6-monthly report is Just Right Scotland. So they've launched a free, confidential, second-tier discrimination advice line. And that is aimed at advisers and other frontline workers directly to support members of the public. So ensuring that the people who are offering these services are trained in a way that responds to the needs of an individual. If they pick up the phone and say, this is not working for me and I need some support to tackle it and challenge it. And that gives, you know, people that opportunity to do that. And that's just another example of all of the organisations that we fund to do that frontline work, where they're much more better placed to understand the needs, the wishes and the challenges that people in Scotland have, especially when their rights are not being realised.
Thanks, Minister. I'm conscious of time, convener, so I will pass back to you, but I really appreciate that response.
OK, thanks. I did say to Pam that if you want to come back in briefly. Yeah.
Thank you, convener. And if it's possible, I'll move on to the issue of minimum core. We heard concerns from the Scottish Women's Budget Group in this committee, but also in other committees, that cuts to employability could, and I quote, remove poverty prevention measures and take targeted support away from disabled people, single parents and women. What conversations are you having with the Deputy First Minister on this?
So that inbox I was telling you about where I have my, you know, for info folder, there's lots of documents that come through that folder that have, for my interest in it, where those conversations are taking place and where those actions are taking place. And even now when you sit down and, you know, you talk to finance officials or I talk to other ministers, they're speaking in panel principles language. And to hear that is really reassuring. What you need to do is then see it in the work they do. So there's a public sector joint ministerial group that meets every few weeks. And there'll not be a time, I think, where I will not have spoken up on behalf of the organisations, the groups and the stakeholders and the individuals who have maybe spoken to me over those last few weeks, always injecting those issues into that. The work that I said that Joe Osga did on the effect to women, so that was one of the groups. It's the same impact on unpaid carers, the same impact on family carers. What I'm hearing right now and being able to feed some of this back about what people are experiencing is around about adult disability payment and child disability payment and how different a process it is. And I just heard from a family who had fought for PIP for years and years and years and got adult disability payment without having to go through all the assessments and everything that they went through. So when I see examples like that, that's where I inject that, because actually putting a real human face on a policy, when I feed that back to the Deputy First Minister and other colleagues, demonstrates quite clearly the impact that the right decisions can make on people's lives. So I will continue to do that. But as I said, I'm always open to hearing ways in which we can do that better. But I will use all of those avenues I have in order to raise these issues as many times as I can.
Thank you. I appreciate that. Specifically on the employability cuts, though, have you made any representation to the Deputy First Minister about timescales, given that a human rights-based approach would require any reduction in funding to be time limited?
So I know that there's you've obviously asked some questions on this in the last few weeks, and I know there's work being done by the minister that's responsible for that. So I'll take that back to say that again you've pushed us in getting that response back to you again. I know how important that employability work is. I know that we have managed to support about 9,000 parents, because some of that fits into the Bright Start Bright Futures, Bright Youth Start Bright Futures, the Child Poverty Action Plan. So some of that works in there with how parents can be supported in order to lift families out of poverty, and there's about 9,000 parents, I think, have been supported through that. So we do see the value in it. We always need to, you know, review whether these things are working or not, but we are in a really difficult situation with our budget, you know, in areas where it's become incredibly difficult when you have to make decisions to cut things that you know are valuable. But in other ways, how can we fund some of the other things that we want to do to make sure that people, you know, don't fall in deeper into poverty? We've always got these things up for review. We make the difficult. I don't envy the minister who had to make that decision at all. And I've looked at some of the decisions I've had to make and make sure that money's focused, you know, to the people and in the places where it needs to be focused the most. But it's not easy. The budget process has not been easy. It's the worst I think I've ever experienced it.
I appreciate that, and thanks for those comments. I guess it's just that in the portfolio that you have, a lot of the difference that will be made for people's lives in terms of equality and human rights will actually be in other people's portfolios where funding is spent. And so I've not been reassured by the Deputy First Minister, and I'm not hearing about specific processes that you've been really clear on with other ministers about how they can, if they're going to cut budgets, the representation you've made to them about the impact that could have on equalities, and if there's anything that you could do to make that clearer for them, because I do worry about some of those funding areas. Health and social care is another example. We heard last week from People First saying that people are having to choose whether or not to go shopping for essential food, pay their get help with the bills or shower, because of cuts to their packages. Yeah. So it's that kind of sense of, like, what sense of importance and urgency and processes are you putting in place to try and make sure that budget decisions in other portfolios take account of equality and human rights?
And that's where the Equality Human Rights Budget Group, you know, help us to understand some of that. But also the Equality and Fairer Scotland budget statement. There are so many acronyms in my head. I've tried to remember them all and not use acronyms because sometimes I don't like acronyms anyway. But so that statement, again, becomes incredibly important in how we do what we do, and the processes are transparent enough for people to understand where they see themselves. And that I will take back the comments you make. I couldn't give you comments on how the minister who's responsible for social care is doing some of that work right now, but I'll give you a commitment to go and look at that and come back with a more detailed response.
Thank you.
And I'll look for that across the whole of government. But the other thing I will say, Pam, is the work that we are doing with the mainstreaming team is incredibly important in making sure that these processes are done in that way, where people are reflected and real human stories are carried through those decision-making processes, in order that we don't have the issues that we have with the comments that were made by stakeholders at your meeting last week. We take all of that very, very seriously, and certainly, you know, I inject all of that across the work that I'm doing. I'm not silent on any of this, as you could imagine, and neither are other ministers, and the government's committed to doing this better. So we'll come back to you in a more detailed response.
Thank you.
That's helpful.
Yep.
Okay, thanks very much. Time is against us, but huge thanks, Minister, and for your officials for attending and giving evidence today. We'll now move into private session.